happier life.
Welcome once again to this second series on decoding optical biometry and formulas. And again, this is an initiative by the AIOS as well as with the help of our sponsors, ZEISS, who have divided this into several parts because the topic is so complex. And today I have a galaxy of speakers with me, and we would be introducing them to you, although they need no introduction. They are so very well known in their field. So the webinar is titled Decoding Optical Biometry and Formulas, and Dr. Mahipal Sachdev, who's the president of AIOS and the chairman and medical director of the Center for Side Group of Hospitals, could not join us today. We have Dr. Chitra Ramamurthy with us today, who has been so vibrant in all her activities as chairperson, academic and research committee of All India Ophthalmological Society, and she's just taken it to a different level. Every week after week, you do see the webinars which are conducted by the ARC, which are so educational and have great scientific content. She again needs no introduction, highly proficient in cataract refractive surgery and glaucoma. She's been doing refractive surgery since 1997 and all the state-of-the-art surgeries right from their inception to the most modern surgical techniques she's well-versed with. She's done innumerable instruction courses, not only in India but abroad, to name a few: ASCRS, ESCRS, CRS, APO, AAO, etc. She has numerous publications to her credit, both nationally and internationally, and contributed to chapters and textbooks on refractive surgeries. And she's also been chairperson scientific committee TONA and MC member TONA. She has several awards to her credit. She's the recipient of the Ravi Kumar Reddy Oration Award, PR Mondal Memorial Oration Award from OSWB, Dr. Sundar Swaran Endowment Oration Award, IMA Coimbatore Chapter 2017, Dr. Om Prakash Gold Medal, Dr. Vinod Arora Oration Award, Dr. Subodh Agarwal Gold Medal, Shiv Prasad Hardia Award for the Best Paper in Refractive Surgery Session at the AIOS, and CP Gupta Best Paper Award at TUNA. And these are very few accolades, I must say, to her credit. There are many more which have not been listed. And above all, she's a great human being, and she's one of the most cheerful persons in our governing council. So thank you, Chitra, for joining us today. Sorry, we have Dr. Rajesh Sinha, I think again needs no introduction, honorary treasurer of AIOS and consultant at Cornea and Refractive Surgery Services, RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, AIIMS, New Delhi. Dr. Rajesh?
It's a great privilege to introduce somebody who obviously needs no introduction. Since the time of my postgraduate days, we have been listening to him, and he is a marvelous teacher and great surgeon, Professor Kiki Mehta, who is Padma Shri awardee. He got this award in 2008 for his contribution to the field of medicine by Government of India. He is the director and chief of Mehta International Eye Institute, Mumbai. And he is also the honorary ophthalmologist to Governor of Maharashtra, Armed Forces of India, and Master. He's past president of Congress since 1996. Is a visiting faculty, ONO Clinic, Del Oil Eye Institute, Geneva, and St. Luke's Institute, Texas. He's member of Vision International Presbyopia Club and Royal Society for Promotion of Health, UK, and holds the legendary honor of the Instituto Barraquer, Barcelona, the only Indian to receive the honor. He's the first Indian to receive Grand Honors Awards of National Eye Research Foundation, Chicago. The Asia Pacific Intraocular Implant Association has awarded him the LIM International Award in 1997, and ASCRS has honored him with Triple Ribbon Award in 1998. He's the recipient of Outstanding Recognition Award of the International Council of Cataract Surgeons and Lifetime Achievement Award of the Medical Integration Council and the West German Chemtech Foundation. Hungarian Cataract and Refractive Surgery Society has awarded him the International Oration Award in Recognition and Appreciation for Excellence in Cataract and Refractive Surgery at the annual conference held in Budapest. And he's the honorary member of the Hungarian Ophthalmological Society. It's a great honor to introduce this giant of ophthalmology in the who not only teaches our national ophthalmologists but also internationally. He's a renowned teacher and a very good orator. Thank you, sir, for being with us. We welcome you.
Again, it's a pleasure to introduce the next speaker again, who obviously is all over India and all over the world. Did his medical degree from Bangalore, Karnataka, and completed postgraduate teaching at RIO Mindro Ophthalmic Hospital, Bangalore Medical College, Bangalore. Was observer fellow in phaco emulsification and LASIK at Shepherd Eye Center, LV, Nevada, USA. Main interests, of course, are cataract and refractive surgery, and he's been at the forefront of all the latest technologies for phaco emulsification and refractive surgery, and he's brought out some very mind-blowing landmark changes in the field of SMILE, the LASIK wavefront surgery, the phakic IOLs, the toric IOLs, conductive keratoplasty, custom view LASIK, and he's received several awards. There is a whole list of awards, and just to name this, Best Phaco and Refractive Surgeon Award for 2006 in IRSI, several of the international awards which are not mentioned here. He's given live surgical demonstrations for phaco and LASIK surgery, and we all have been a witness to it. And his surgeries just flow like water before you realize they're already over. And he has numerous publications and peer-reviewed publications again, which have changed the way we do clinical practice in refractive surgery as well as phaco emulsification. Also recipient of the IRSI Gold Medal. And he's the chairman and managing director of Netradhama Hospital Private Limited and managing trustee of Shraddha Eye Care Trust, Padmanabha Nagar, Bangalore.
It's great pleasure to introduce Tarub Bhaumik, who is consultant in cataract, cornea, and refractive services at Dishai Hospital, Barakpur. He is working as a consultant there, and he has been trained in laser from. He has done a fellowship in laser from Arvind Eye Hospital, Madurai. He has done his post graduation from RIO Calcutta. And he has received several awards, and some of which are the grand prize, the best of the best for his video, Out or In. It is the out or in. It is the same door at the ACRS Boston 2010. He is the first Indian to receive this prestigious award. He also received an award for the best video for his video at ACRS, and the award in the innovation sections category of ASCRS Film Festival for another video at San Francisco, USA, 2013. He has demonstrated surgical techniques in many national conferences, international conferences, and also at an international conference at Sisendo Eye Hospital, Burden. He has been done instruction courses at various places, both internationally and nationally, especially at ASCRS, ESCRS, and All India Conference. So he's a wonderful human being, a very good surgeon, and a very dear friend. So welcome to Dr. Arup Bhaumik.
It's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Anand Shroff, who's done MS Ophthalmology, FICS Fellow in International College of Surgeons, laser vision correction. He's an experienced anterior segment and refractive surgeon. Again, he is an expert at various surgeries, as we all know him. All the refractive surgeries, including the Relax, SMILE, LASIK, EpiLASIK, tropoguided treatments, cataract, including accommodative and toric implants, glaucoma, and corneal disorders. And he has more than 17 years of experience in LASIK and cataract surgeries. He's the specialist in LASIK cataract and glaucoma at Shroff Eye Hospital, Mumbai, with excellence in patient services for 100 years, and is the first and only eye hospital in India to be awarded the Joint Commission International Accreditation, having been re-accredited 3 times till date. Now, he's one of the first ophthalmologists to use the advanced accommodative and multifocal lens implants technology and methods, and pioneer of the wavefront guided and topo-guided LASIK in the country. And he's first in India and one of the very few in the world to use the Concerto 500 Hertz laser, and which is one of the fastest and the safest lasers in the world. And he's the only surgeon from India to be invited to European Refractive Laser Symposium, which was held in Istanbul, Turkey in June 2014 on Smile, Relax, and other laser procedures. So we welcome Dr. Anand Shaw, and we look forward to hearing from you soon. So after the introductions, it is my pleasure to now invite Dr. Sri Ganesh to give his talk on biometry after the laser vision correction. Dr. Sri Ganesh has another commitment and will, after giving the talk, will not be available for the entire session. So if you have any questions, please post them on the Facebook, YouTube, and on our Zoom platform. Before that, I think I would request Dr. Chitra to say a few words before we finally start the session. Chitra, you have to unmute yourself.
Really look forward to a very interesting session on IOL Master and biometry and the relevance of these advanced formulae and how they are going to improve our emmetropic outcome. And because I think we started treating all surgeries as very premium surgeries, and the expectations of patients have really gone up. And with these absolute top-notch speakers, I'm very sure there is going to be a lot of information which all of us are going to gather, and look forward to an interesting session.
Thank you, Chitra. Dr. Sri Ganesh.
Thank you, Dr. Namrata. And I would like to thank AOS and ZEISS for inviting me to this webinar to share my experience with post-refractive surgery biometry. Let me just share my screen. Is it visible?
No, it's not visible. It's getting cut, I think.
It is half.
Sir, can you stop share and then reshare, sir? Just share on the first option.
No, it's not. Okay. Is it?
No. Sorry, it's still coming as half. Can you just,
No, it's better?
Yeah.
It's
okay. Now it's okay. Okay.
Okay. Sorry about that. So let us start with the first topic, that is post-refractive surgery IOL power calculation. I am a consultant to Carl Zeiss Meditech. So the number of refractive surgeries being performed world over have been increasing. And also we are seeing an increased number of post-refractive patients presenting with age-related cataract. I myself, I've been doing refractive surgery for over 25 years now. And so I get to see a lot of my patients whom I have operated for LASIK coming back to me for cataract surgery. And we all know that refractive surprises are quite common after cataract surgery in such patients, and this leads to patient dissatisfaction. So accurate biometry is the key to ensure best visual outcomes. So what is the problem post-refractive surgery? How does it differ from regular biometry? Basically, all of you all know that there is a relationship between the anterior and posterior corneal curvature. And this ratio is known as the Gullstrand's ratio, and it is fixed at around 0.9, 0.92. But after corneal refractive surgery, you're changing the shape of the cornea and also the thickness of the cornea. So what happens is, like you can see here in myopic LASIK, the central area is flattened. whereas hyperopic LASIK, the central curvature is steepened, either with LASIK, SMILE, or PRK, any corneal surgery. So there is a change in the Gullstrand's ratio. And when there is a change in the Gullstrand's ratio, most of the normal formulae, they take this fixed ratio, they assume a fixed ratio, and this posterior curvature power is compensated by changing the corneal refractive index in the formulae. So when this Gullstrand ratio is altered, then you can have errors in biometry. If you look at conventional keratometers, the corneal power is calculated in the 3 mm zone. Average can be 2.8 to 3.7. And with the assumption of fixed anterior to posterior corneal curvature ratio, which is the Gullstrand's ratio. And the central part of the cornea is not imaged. And as you all know, that after refractive surgery, whether it's myopic or hyperopic corneal refractive surgery, the central area curvature is changed maximally, and the rate of change of slope from the center to the periphery is altered. This normal relationship is altered. So this is also one of the issues. So what happens when you use third generation formulas? The other problem is that when you use a formulae like Hoffa Q, Holiday 1, or SRKT, the keratometric reading and the axial length are taken into consideration for the anterochamber depth. But when the keratometric reading is altered because of refractive surgery, then you get an inaccurate anterochamber depth. And this basically causes an inaccurate calculation of the effective lens position. And this also gives rise to errors in the biometry. So these are all the problems as to why you can have biometry errors post-refractive surgery. Now the solution is you can overcome this by measuring the or estimating the true corneal power. So you can measure it objectively, or you can apply correction factors for the keratometry to get the true corneal power so that you're not dependent on the fixed ratio, Gullstrand's ratio. So using, otherwise you will have to use formulae which are not solely relying on keratometry and axial length, or you can add in correction factors for accurate estimation of the effective lens position. So measuring or estimating the true corneal power, you can objectively do it using the total keratometry or TK. This is available with the IUL Master 700, which is a swept source OCT. The other correction factor is that you can apply correction factor for keratometry using the Pentacam EKR values. Now coming to using formula which are not solely relying on keratometry and axial length, or those that use correction factors for accurate estimation of ELP, they are the Holiday 2 and the Barrett TrueK Universal 2 formula. So the conventional approach is look for the pre-op refractive data before the patient underwent refractive surgery. If you have the K readings and the refraction, that's the history method. You can also use the online calculators for this. And it is prudent to compare various methods and see the, look at the values for the IULs. After the online calculators, and then you can take a decision. So you have the history versus the no history methods. So if you look at this, this is an online formula where you put in all the data. If you have access to OCT, then you can put in the net corneal power, posterior corneal power, central corneal thickness, and also K1, K2, axial length, etc. And you have IUL calculation formulas for post-refractive surgery. You can visit the ASCRS website where they have post-refractive surgery formulae. And you have the double K, Holiday 1, Shamas, Haggis, L, than OCT-based formulae, Barrett-Truque formulae. So basically, they can be classified as using prior data or without using any other prior data, where you put in the details. So in our hospital, we undertook a study to evaluate and compare the performance of three formulae, which are now currently being used and are popular. One is the TK with Barrett's Universal 2, and the other was the Pentacam EKR with the Holiday 2, and then the Barrett True K post-refractive surgery formulas for post-refractive surgery eyes. So if you use the Holiday equivalent keratometric detailed report, or what is known as the EKR with the Pentacam, you'll have to select the 4.5 mm zone and use the values in this 4.5 mm zone, and then apply the Holiday to formulate. It also gives you the distribution of EKR, and then this graph is very important because it kind of indicates the centration of the ablation. And if you get a nice Gaussian curve, that means it's well-centered and the distribution of Ks are uniform and the cornea is not very regular. So that information also you can get from this. So 4.5 mm, you use the Holiday 2. And there are several publications on this that using the 4.5 mm EKR plus Holiday 2 is fairly accurate for calculating IUL power for post-refractive surgery patients. The other formula we used was the total keratometry, or TK. So this is a novel method combining telecentric keratometry and swept source OCT. This is available in the IUL Master 700, where you can actually measure the postracorneal curvature. And it also has the inbuilt Barrett TK Universal 2 and Barrett TK Toric formulae. So let us see how this works. Basically, the total keratometry, the IUL Master 700 uses telecentric three-zone keratometry, and you get the toric model of the anterior surface of the cornea. The swept source OCT B-scans give you the corneal thickness at various points, and it gives you the intracorneal distances between the anterior and posterior curvature. From this, the posterior 3D points are calculated so as to get a posterior torus fit of the posterior curvature of the cornea. And then an calibration is applied to actually get the posterior corneal surface values. And then this is incorporated to power matrices and a thick lens formula. And you get the biometric, the TK values, total keratometric values. So this was a retrospective study, and we had 30 eyes from 18 patients aged around 56 years, and history of any form of corneal refractive procedure presenting with age-related cataract undergoing phaco by a single experienced surgeon. Five eyes were excluded due to serious ocular conditions. So pre-op, the axial length, keratometric power, and ACD were measured by the IOL Master 700. And topography using the Pentacam HR to get the EKR values. The power of the implanted lens, we used only one type of lens, the Technis one, because you can have a little variation in the EPL if you use different models of lenses. This was determined using the three formulae, the Barrett Truque post-refractive surgery formulae, EKR plus Holiday 2, and the TK plus Barrett Universal 2. With the IOL Master software. The IOL constant was taken from ULIB, and IOL power was calculated using the Barrett True K post-refractive surgery formula. So coming to the results, okay, these are the eyes, and most of them were post-myopic LASIK, but we also had post-hyperopic LASIK, post-RK, post-relaxed smile, post-presbyopia, and post-PRK. These are the results. We looked at the prediction of mean absolute error, which is MAE, and the post-op refractive errors 2 months after cataract surgery ranged from minus 0.75 to plus 0.50, which is a very good result. And the mean absolute error was calculated as the average of the absolute value of actual minus the predicted spherical equivalence of the post-op refractive error. So the biometry gives you a predicted outcome, and then this is actually compared with the actual outcomes to derive the mean absolute error. And if you look at the mean absolute error with the TK and Barrett Universal 2, the average error was 0.48. With the EKR and Holiday 2, it was 0.72, and with the Barrett Rookie, it was 0.74. So all the three formulae performed well, but we found that the TK with the Universal 2 was slightly better. The advantages of the TK are there is no reliance on the pre-op history. So even if you don't have the pre-op details, you can just do the biometry like you do for all other patients. You objectively measure the actual values, the posterior curvature, and you use the new generation IUL formula for prediction of ELP, which is the Barrett's TK. So this is the first study comparing TK with other established formula, post-refractive eyes. And as you can see, all formula performed well. Total keratometry with Barrett TK provided comparatively better predictable outcomes. But of course, we need larger data to further establish this. And now there is a new formula called TrueK TK. The Barrett TrueK TK, where he has incorporated both the TrueK and the TK. It is not available right now on the IUL Master 700, but you can probably go to the website and then do the calculation, and that is supposed to give the best results and predictability. But what you all have to understand is you'll have to find out the need of the patient, and counseling is critical to avoid dissatisfaction in patients with prior refractive surgery, because you can always get some amount of refractive surprises, and you should be very careful while using premium IOLs. Thank you. We will go on to the other topic again. I think I'll share those slides. Which is the new development in the IOL Master 700. I'll just briefly talk about it. Okay. Okay, can you see my screen now? Is it okay?
Yes.
Yeah, so this the IUL Master 700 now has a new update. So it comes with central topography. And the workflow, basically there is no change in workflow. So you can use the IUL Master as you are using it right now, but central topography is incorporated in the workflow. So you don't have to actually do topography with another topographer, especially for your premium IOLs and your toric IOLs, or even your regular biometry. And you can detect any visual relevant corneal asymmetries. And you can also get the central corneal shape information very easily. And there are various data transfers available. You can use the EQ mobile or the Holiday consultant. So you, as all of you all know, preoperative evaluation of a cataract patient should include corneal topography, regardless of the type of IOLs, but it's especially more important for toric and multifocal IOLs, because any corneal irregularities in the central optical zone can reduce vision and the outcomes. So this IOL Master 700 now incorporates this central corneal topography without any changes in workflow. And it also provides the anterior and total axial power maps. So you can visually, just by a glance, detect any corneal irregularities. So this is the total power map. It's measured in the 3 mm. The pupil diameter has to be 3 millimeters, and the topography diameter is 4.8 mm, and the scale is in 0.5 adapter steps. So it helps you in your workflow and patient decision. After doing the biometry, you also get the central topography. Then you can discuss with the patient and decide about the type of IOL which is suitable for the patient, whether they are suitable for the toric IOL. If there are any central irregularities, then they may not be ideal. Like if you can pick up keratoconus or early ectasia, then they may not be ideal candidates for premium IOLs. So this is the information that you have without any extra effort or extra equipment. So the acquisition is quite easy, and you, as you acquire it, you, along with your axial lengths and your K readings, you also get the keratometry and the topography. And you also have the traffic light signals there. So green tick means that the acquisition is quite good. And it takes less than 45 seconds for both eyes. You can get all the measurements. So of course, this is about telecentric keratometry. That means basically if the patient is moving the head still, the you get very accurate K readings in the corneal curvature is measured in 18 spots. And an anterior surface model is constructed, keratometric index is applied, and you derive the anterior axial power maps. So you also have the swept source OCT. This is something which I had spoken about previously. So you also get the posterior surface model and the total axial power maps because you have the posterior surface also. There are several studies which were done by Doc Koch and Dr. Wang, and where they compared central topography with other Schlemflip topographies to see if it can pick up corneal conditions, 105 eyes. So they found that central topography provides similar overall shape and symmetries in majority of the cases. And this is the scaling with the IOL Master 700 central topography. So you have the range from 34 adapters to 54 adapters in 0.5 steps and 41 colors. So just by looking at it, you can see steep is red, normal is a mixture of green is the average normal. And this is a normal topography. If it's blue, it's a flatter cornea. And you can detect cases of regular or irregular astigmatism very easily by just looking at these maps. They were compared with the Galilei 4 mm maps, and they had a very good agreement. So the excellent comparability with the rule, against the rule, etc. These are just the conclusions of the study. So this is the new let me stop sharing the screen. So this is the new development in the IOL Master 700, and where you get corneal topography, which is very useful for post-refractive surgery and also to decide about premium IOLs. So with that, I would like to end my talk and thank you very much for your attention. If there are any questions, a couple of minutes, Dr. I can take them.
Yes, Sri Ganesh, I have a question for you. Do you feel that this concept of measuring the posterior corneal power has, especially with IOL Master 700, that has a greater relevance in normal corneas or in post-LASIK eyes?
It's more relevant in post-refractive surgery because even in normal eyes, the regular universal 2, Barrett universal 2 works very well. But in post-refractive surgery cases, because the Gull-Strands ratio is altered, and even the effective lens position, again, can be off. So because of this, and you don't take the central K. It's measured in the 3 millimeter, where post refractive surgery maximum changes occur in the central K. So because of this, if you take the total corneal power, then you're overcoming these difficulties and you get a more predictable outcome.
Shri Ganesh, there is a question again, which says that post myopic and hyperopic, among them both in which the laser correction has been done, where do you think post-operatively after you put a premium IOL, the satisfaction will be more?
See, with post-myopic, we find that satisfaction is better because the risk of decentration and induced abrasions are less with post-myopic corneal refractive surgery. In post-hyperopic LASIK or PRK, especially with large angle kappas, you can have decentration and you also have induced abrasions, especially coma. So when you put a premium IUL in these cases, then you can have patient dissatisfaction. So it's ideal to do the pentacam EKR. And like I said, you look at the distribution of the case. So if you have a nice Gaussian curve in the EKR distribution, then even for hyperopic, it should be okay.
Yes, Chitra, you wanted to say something?
It's a question which I could have asked later, but because you're leaving, I thought I'll ask now. Yeah. Why do you think the Indian multifocals are nowadays doing as good as the imported multifocals? Would you give credit to the IOL design mainly or more?
It is the design. One is the design, and the second is the accuracy of manufacturing. I have visited a few of these plants both abroad. I visited the Alcon plant in Ireland, the J&J plant in Groningen, and also I visited the Indian factories in Ahmedabad. What I find is the most of the equipment is imported and the material also is imported. So what is important is the quality control, and they do a good job of it now because the rejection rate is almost the same as the imported lenses. So they undergo, after the lens is finished, they actually check with advanced devices, look at the MTF, look at the power, and then only if the lenses are past the quality check, then they are allowing them to be sold. And then what I find that is the design also is very good. The trifocals, especially the near and intermediate, and the finishing is very good. So we have done some comparative studies and we find that the Indian trifocal lenses are as good as the ones you get abroad. And most of these, many of these lenses are also manufactured abroad. So it's not Indian or imported. Now most of them are whether it's an Indian-based multinational or a US-based multinational is the question.
I feel most strongly, I'm very sorry, Namita, I feel very strongly that it is the optical biometry and the various factors, the way we measure it, and the formulas which have so many variables for better judging even some years back, there were more complaints, but we do not get complaints at all from our patients because we are able to hit emetropia a lot more with the best of formulae now. So I feel that is
when you're using a premium lenses, whether it is imported or Indian, the sphere has to be less than 0.25, within 0.25, and the cylinder within 0.4. So it's very important to pay attention to biometry and also correction of astigmatism. That's very important. So if you have residual astigmatism, then the patient satisfaction is not good, even though if your sphere is zero. So this is something that you have to keep in mind. Irrespective of the lens, you have to be on target, and only then you get the satisfaction with the premium IOL.
Ganesh, there's another question that does the topography map, do you have personal experience with this topography map of IOL Master? One is that. And I think it would be having it, but the question is, does the topography of this IOL Master 700 also mention the axis? I'm sure it would be there. But what is your personal experience with the topography map?
I do not have any personal experience right now. The software is being installed right now to conduct a study. We are going to conduct a study and we will be publishing it. But what I have seen and from What I've heard from my colleagues who have been using it is that it is fairly accurate. I mean, you cannot compare it to a topography because you don't get some peripheral data. For example, if you have a pellucid marginal degeneration, you may miss it completely because it just gives the central 4.8 millimeter. So this is important basically to rule out irregularities. If you have a form frustrate keratoconus or irregular astigmatism, then whether you decide to go in for a toric or not, decide to go in for a premium IOL or not. It cannot replace a topographer, but it gives you, it's a quick screening device to see the central maps and to pick up any irregularities in the center of the cornea.
It doesn't give the axis yet. It only gives the anterior cornea curvature details and the irregularity.
I'm sure it must be giving
it gives axis. You the axis because the axis is similar to your keratometric axis. So it will give you the axis.
There's another question that if you do take this value from your EKR maps, Pentachem HR maps, you take a EKR value and you use it with Barrett Universal 2 formula in eyes with no prior refractive surgery. Is it possible to do that? And do you think
no.
it will give equivalent results to what it gives when you don't use the Pentachem EKR?
No, the Pentachem EKR has to be used with the Holiday 2. You cannot mix the formulas because what happens is the formulas, different formulas have different keratometric indices. And these keratometric indices are kind of calibrated so that to compensate for the posterior cornea. So you cannot mix the EKR values with the Barrett Universal 2 because the Barrett Universal 2 or the Barrett True K has some adjustments for post-refractive surgery, especially the True K. And the Universal 2 also is a little different because the ELP is calculated for normal corneas. So ideally, you should use this only with the Holiday 2 formula. And that's what we did in our study. And with that, it's fairly accurate.
Dr. Rajesh, would you have any questions before we allow Sri Ganesh to go?
Leave. No, actually, what I felt that it's the total K that is a real, I mean, accurate calculation of the total K is the real game changer. And that has, I mean, I was just going through a couple of studies also, which has shown that the predictive value has, it's quite good. And the prediction error has reduced quite significantly with this total K. So I guess that is the main game changer. I mean, even for a normal cornea, or in normal cornea also the prediction error has reduced. And in refractive corneas, because the risk of prediction error is very high, and when you calculate because of this Gull-Strand ratio and because this changes significantly after refractive surgery, the total K really is the real game changer in terms of getting minimal prediction error.
See, even in cases where the Gull-Strand ratio is not altered much, like in RK, in post-RK cases, there's no thinning of the cornea. So the Gull-Strand ratio is not altered, the ratio between the anterior and posterior, though there is a significant flattening. But still, I think the accuracy using TK is better. That's what we found even in post-RK eyes. But again, post-RK is a totally different ballgame. It's very difficult to be accurate with post-RK.
Okay, before you leave, Sri Ganesh, what are your tips and tricks for post-RKI's correction of the IOL path?
See, now we are looking at various formulas, and right now we are looking at ray tracing also because we have the MS-39, which gives ray tracing. And we find that it's with the ray tracing and TK is quite good. The results are quite good because many of the other formulas like the ACRS formulae or the EKR with Holiday do not work so well with RK, post-RK, as well as, I mean, they work well with post-LASIK, post-PRK, but for post-RK, I feel that the TK, Barrett TK or ray tracing will be a better option. And post-RK also, I kind of err more towards a little bit of myopia, about 0.75 diopter myopia, because there's a lot of hyperopic shift and diurnal variation. And I find that this also helps.
I guess in post-RK, still there is some risk of prediction error because all these nomograms have not been based on post-RK. So
So if you use ray tracing, then you don't need nomograms. So that's what I'm trying to say.
Absolutely.
Ray tracing may be better.
True.
So thank you, Sri Ganesh.
Thank you. I have to leave for the other webinar. Yeah, thank you so much and all the best. Thank you.
Dr. Rajesh will call the next speaker.
We have none other than Dr. K.K. Mehta, who will be talking about Callisto system and markless toric IOL implantation.
Sir.
No, this is not the one. Okay, you can see my screen, I hope.
Yes.
Yeah, we can see your screen.
I'm going to talk to you today about the Callisto system.
Slides are not open.
Sir, can you just stop share first? Open your presentation and then do the screen share.
Okay, stop share, then do.
Open the presentation.
Okay.
Now do the screen share, sir.
Just a sec. Okay, now I want me to do screen share. Screen share, okay. All right. You
all
got
good,
it
sir.
Now?
Yes, and now, yeah,
good. All okay?
Perfect.
Great. I'm going to talk to you a little about a system which has made life very easy for me. I mean, we talk a lot about how accurate an implant should be and how accurately we can assess everything. But the point remains in the end, how accurately can you fit it? Because there lies the rub, as one would say. If you can't fit it accurately, then all the investigation you've done, all the formulas you've applied, literally go to naught. And as one would say, perhaps the greatest offender and detractor which stands between good and poor vision is astigmatism. Therefore, correction and exact positioning of your implant is vitally important. When we are doing quality lenses, or even if you're doing a regular lens, the most important factor is the wow factor. The next day, the patient should sit in your chair. He should be happy. And he should say, great doc, I'm happy, I can see well. In multifocal IOLs, even a residual astigmatism of 0.75 can lead to a poor functioning and lead to a lot of problems, including poor reading vision. And nowadays, people are, as one would say, they want a lot. Dil mange more, as the saying goes, and they really need more. The answer is simple if you use a mono, but in the next step, the important thing is how do you fit it at the proper axis? Various instruments have been used since the ages. All sorts of alternate methods have been designed. And perhaps the most accurate before this new systems came were the Akahoshi electronic marker system, which I also had the pleasure of using for some time. But going back, the precision is important. The question is why? 40% of surgeons think that 10% of rotational errors are acceptable, but that is not true. If you are axis is off by even a very small figure, the power of the lens which you have really changes radically so that you don't get the effect which you require. And if you're off by 30 degrees, that means you really have nothing left over. In the status quo, as one would say, of toric IOLs, a number of such studies have shown essentially that cataract procedures which involve a toric IOL, a lot of patients are not getting the quantum of astigmatic control which they really deserve and which they require. So the accuracy of placement is vitally important, as important as in designing a watch, for that matter. If we can calculate an IOL with perfect accuracy, but if we can't place it, all the efforts are wasted. And that is there exactly where this direct way of precise IOL using the markerless system came into place. When I first bought the system, I thought it was a great waste of money. I could just as accurately mark it with myself utilizing a slit lamp, which is what I did, or utilize the Akahoshi system, which I thought was great. But it's only when you start using these systems, then you come to realize what it really matters. One of the big advantages of this system is that you can do your biometry. And the data goes on to a little drive. You feed in the drive into the Callisto. which gives you all the information transferred across, and then the data is transferred into the eyepiece of the operating microscope. I use a Zeiss 700, which gives me the data inside. And the big advantage is that I can at the same time see what I'm doing, as I'll demonstrate to you in a little later on. So the whole secret essentially is that you must get not only an accurate measurement device system. I use the 700. I've started using the topography system, which we have just been talking a few minutes ago. And personally, I feel that the accuracy of the biometer itself has improved. I have a feeling that what Zeiss has done is it's taken the direct topography readings and fed them in addition to the topography evaluation it originally had, and that has enhanced the accuracy. Because in the last 3 months that I've been using it with the topographer built in, it does seem to make a difference. Also, the other interesting factor is the topographer, which comes with the IOL master, measures only the central 3 to 4 millimeter zone, which is the area through which the patient is going to see subsequently. So it gives you a pretty accurate idea as to what is happening. With the regular topographer, you get a big view. And as they say, you know, when you're seeing 3D or stereoscopic, the small little abrasions in the middle get missed out. The other advantage of the Callisto system is that you can utilize a Zeiss forum to get your details. And of course, you can feed your data in. So this, I think, does make a significant difference. It has made a difference to me. My regular routine in my regular work is 30% of all my IOLs, which I do, or sometimes even more, are multifocals. And therefore, for me, getting a perfect accuracy is really important. And the advantage of doing a transfer utilizing a jack means that you no longer have to worry about data being fed in the morning or not. If you have a long list, you are always worried as to whether your assistant has had his breakfast and whether he is going to feed the data in accurately. Because in the end, you are scrubbed. We are not going to feed anything. So this system by which you call what I call as a seamless data transfer does make a significant difference. And the big advantage is not only is the safety, but the fact that your information is comes across onto you and it's available under your eyepiece. So you know exactly what you are seeing. And the advantage, as one would say, is that it gives you the information where you want it. The other advantage of getting the data fed into the eyepiece, which is there both with the Zeiss as well as with the Alcon system, mine is a Zeiss system, is that there's no distraction from the surgical field. Not only that, if the eye rotates, your image will rotate with it. So the toric changes which tend to occur when a person lies down compared to a measurement is in the vertical sitting position is no longer there. So it has many advantages. And the big advantage also is that it causes no distortion. So the accuracy of fitting becomes much better. And you get a perfect red reflex, which is great as far as surgery is concerned. Let me just show you in a video so we know what it is then before I talk about it. I don't want sound.
Yes. Audio, can we increase the audio?
Yeah. I'm going to shut off the audio because it's better that you hear me talk rather than talking to music.
Sure.
So basically, I'm going to talk to you about how it is done. I'm going to talk to you steps as it runs down the line. So you get an idea of what it can do. First of all, the big advantage is once your data is fed in, as you're operating down the line, this is the surgery as it runs. I've not edited it. So it's basically an unedited version, as one would say, virtually unedited. And this is my routine type of surgery, which I normally do. I use my diamonds to make the opening here. You can now lay on the cornea the exact size which you want to do and the size of the rexes which you like to do. As you're aware, when I do phaco, I like to tumble my lenses out. So I normally use a slightly larger rexes size than others do. My normal rexes size is 5.5 millimeter. And the big advantage here is you can get a perfectly round rexes. Sometimes the quality of rexes you get is so good, you wonder as to whether I wonder sometimes whether I should have actually bought the other system which we utilize for doing a cataract surgery, which is the Catalyst. Now, as you have on options of changing the color, that's why I put red, blue, and green. You can alter it to any color which you like. I normally prefer to use blue. It gives me a sharper image. But a lot of people have said that red is better used to use. So this gives you the level and the axis which you desire. Notice that as the eye changes or torques, the image moves with the torque, so that at all times you can get the centering precise fitting exactly as you wanted. And that's a toric lens which is being fitted. This is a Zeiss lens. And you can then center it to fit it exactly as you want it to fit. So it has the advantage that you can get a perfect fitting system at all times. And that is exactly where you like to do. And once you get it, you know that you have literally placed your lens where you want it to. And let us quickly look at some of the results as we have run down our refractive surgeries done. This is just a small series of 3,500 odd cases, which we had done pre-op and post-op. This is a residual power which we try to get. And the frequency of cylindrical power, that is the important thing which you are looking at. As you notice, most of them accurately come there. Once in a while, some of them jump out. And that is, this was before the new TK values started coming in. This is before the TK. Now that the TK values have started coming in and that we're utilizing it on the IOL Master 700, it has made again a difference. Our best corrected visions are fine and our patients are happy, which is the most important thing which we need to really there, because they are the ones who are going to refer the cases to you. Patient symptoms which you tend to do, we tend after a month after the surgery, we ask them for glare and halos and double vision and night driving difficulties. Just remember, never ask them for the first month. In the first month, there's a certain amount of corneal haze which is there. So that causes all these complaints to increase. So ask them all your complaints afterwards. You do get a few night driving difficulty, a little bit of double vision, occasional halos, but these are all within limits. The important thing is, just remember that what you tell a patient before you operate him is considered quite normal. If you tell him that after the operation, around a headlight, he will see two or three rings, he is not bothered. But you tell him after the surgery, he says, ka complication ho gaya, you may not have fitted the lens properly. So try and give the patient as much data as possible. I have often turned around and said that the most important instrument that you can buy is essentially a counselor. Because she is the one or he is the one who will really make life interesting for you. In summary, thus, precision and every step of your toric workplace is important. You not only need to have precise measurements, you need to have a perfect time-saving markerless alignment. And of course, you need to have a proper selection of your toric models matching to give you the results that you really want. So in conclusion, many developments will come. But the final aim is total spectacle independence with excellent visual outcomes. And that is ultimately where we all want to go for. And as I tell all my patients that you will have this, but there's always certain amount which you give. So you have to tell them this, as one would say, that everyone wants happiness, no one wants pain. But you can't have a rainbow without a little rain. In the sense that an occasional halo is quite normal, but in lieu of that halo, you're getting an excellent quality of vision. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much. Again, like always, it was a pleasure to watch your surgery and your unedited video, which, you know, finishes faster than our edited videos also. So thank you so much, sir. I think we will take the next talk, and then we'll take the questions. The next talk is going to be by Dr. Arup Bhaumik, and he's going to be talking about biometry for premium IOLs. Chitra, meanwhile, would you want to ask something from sir?
Chitra, you are mute.
Markerless systems are truly good, but I think the further advantage we have with the Barrett's RX formulae and all is now we can plan whether if we have a residual error, whether we have to just realign it on the axis or we have to change the IOL. I do an IOL exchange or do we do a piggyback? So we have come to a point that everything has got added together to give us very optimal results.
Dr. Arup, can you just adjust your this thing, because it is not coming in the slideshow, it is getting cut from the left side.
You know, nowadays as we are working, we are finding the use of Tracy more and more, because simultaneously with all this work that we do, the Tracy really gives us the details. I've started now doing Tracy regularly post all our cataract patients to evaluate them. And sometimes you get some surprising results. Sometimes the IOLs do rotate despite whatever they talk. So, I mean, and the tracy has the advantage that you can always know exactly where to flip them back.
I think you should stop.
Yeah, perfect.
Arup, it has come.
Yeah. Good evening. It's my great pleasure to share the same dais with Dr. Keki, Professor Keki Mehta. Thank you, AIS and RGIS, for giving me the opportunity. And once again, I thank express my gratitude to AIS for governing body to organizing wonderful academic session the last almost 1 year, more than 1 year. And today's my topic is biomimicry for ischemic IOL. What are the critical factors? And we are going slightly reverse. Actually, Dr. Sivanesh discussed a lot of things regarding the premium biometric critical factor. I'll skip my slide. I don't think there is a duplication. I have no financial interest to disclose. The goal is basically cataract surgery, restoration of clear vision. But goal of the premium IOL implantation, not only the restoration of clear vision, but also the correction or significant improvement of phase myopia, and it's a correction in linear sightedness and or astigmatism. These are the considered as the IOL premium IOL, but it definitely varies from doctors to doctors and patient to patient. That the all surgery are premium and all lenses are premium. These are the commonly talked about the premium IOL. And I consider all the multifocal, lead-off, trifocal, or the recently introduced in the market CRV IOL. When the ATR in the TK is almost, I will discuss the TK already discussed. TK, what is the value of total keratometry value? It's 0.75 or WTR 1 diopter. But more than that, I will prefer to give the any platform with the toric platform. So look at the defocus curve. If you the landing zone of these diffractive IOL or kind of diffractive IOL like trifocal IOL or EDOF IOL, landing zone error of margin in biometry is very less. So if you see that this highest vision logmar chart is achieved in the near ametropia with the 0.5 plus and minus, and if you once able to land in the ametropic zone, then when it's everything will come in right position. So if you miss that, then it's very difficult to satisfy the patient. So patient selection is free, and you should be very critical, right lens for the right patient. But with the invention of the new technology or trifocal, already discussed that your range. We are not so critical like we are previously with the bifocal IOL. So we are more and more reluctant and easily implant the EDOF and trifocal IOL due to the excellent technology of the lens optic. So apart from this premium critical factor, the patient selection, biometry formula, biometry machine, aberration measurement, angle kappa, and the surgical factor also very important to give the perfect result. So let us talk biometric consideration. I will talk about the biometric formula, a little bit of a literature review, biometry reports, I understand the biometric report, how to see the biometric report, how to see the validation of the report and the biometric machine. The lens, the quest started almost 75 years back when the first lens was implanted and came out with 20 diopters. Right. So since then, the biometric pillar evolved from SRK2, the newer generation formula. You can see the SRK1 and SRK2 has a fixed ELP position, considered as a fixed ELP position. But after the third generation formulas came in the early 80s, 1980s or late 1980s, and this become a variable ELP according to the K or axial length to determine the ELP. And later it is a Van Gogh adjustment came in much later. and the fourth or fifth generation, these are the multiple variables which use the to detect the ELP. So these are the classification formula for the base of the derivation. And the regression formula is SRK1, SRK2. And then these are the Vargens formula. The Vargens formula is basically a theoretical formula considering the Gaussian optics. So two variables is SRK2, Holliday 1, and Hopper Q. Here is the 7 variable in Holliday 2 and the 5 variable in the Barrett Universal 2. The regressing, this is a new concept introduced by the Olson, and also it is in the FECO optics. It is a different, slightly different kind of formula, which is also invented by the Dr. Olson. And these are the new concept of the regressing technique. So I just discussed these new formulas little bit. The Holliday 2, they use the 7 variables: axial length, K reading, white white, view of refraction, patient age, lens thickness, and anterior chamber, 7 parameters to detect the ELP position of the IOL. So it is the most popular formula before 2010. After then, the Holliday, this is a new formula, is become more popular. Olson formula is a new concept of the C constant. It eliminates eliminates the ELP with the relation with kilometer value, axial length, white to white. It came with the C factor, the constant factor. This C factor actually decides where the length is fitting, and it detects the actual ELP position. The ELP is decided as a ACD plus C into the length thickness. This is this came into the market in the 2011, and it is published in the in BJO in the large data, almost 1,000 cases the data in 2014, and it is only available so far in the LensStar platform. Biometry machine. The Hill RVH is came into the in 2016 or late 15. It used the AI and regression analysis of very large database and for the refractive outcome of predictive IOL. And it is also free. It is free and also available in the ACRS daughter. It's a huge database on database, and it is increases over time, and it is getting better and better every day, because now this is a Hill RVF C data just released and derived from larger data set, expanded biometry range, and it Hill RVF biometry also taken into the consideration with the ethnicity, the gender, and it is Asian statistics, Asian data also in available. This Hill RVF formula is basically dependent on the axial length, K, ACD, CCP, white to white, length thickness, and gender. Remember, this is not a formula. It is a database. It is a matching with the, it is a pattern recognition. It gives you inbound whether this prediction value is reliable. And the value are highly probable within 0.5 targeted outcome. Outbound means the data showing prediction value is not matched with targeted outcome within 0.5, or there is not enough data to validate. This is not a formula. It is validate your result. It came from the huge database and give you your correct result. And this is a RVF calculator. Looks like it is free in the ACRS website. Now the KM formula, it is basically combination of artificial intelligence and the theoretical optics, and require all LKK and gender. This also available in the IOLformula.com, available in the website. It is a free, and comparison is the same in BJO published in 2018 and 19. Rather, comparison of KM with the existing formula for the intraocular IOL power. This is the latest formula which came into the market. And now this is the most popular formula, IOL formula for almost 7 years, this become the most popular formula. Barrett Universal 2, already discussed, part of the discussed by Dr. Ganesh, is based on the theoretical model I, and it is taken into consideration principal plane, a change in the principal plane of the variety of IOL by the means of lens factor. Furthermore, it estimates ELP based on the antechamber depth, lens factor relation to the actual position and the location of the principal plane of the different IOL power. It has also utilized the five variables. It is a actual lens, keratometry reading, and antechamber depth, lens thickness, and what to height to measure the ELP. Barrett, and it also available APCRS is a free to use, and everyone can use this Barrett 2 formula. So these are the all formula. When we are considering the premium IOL, which formula is we should use, and whether we should use the multiple formula, and it is a really needed for different formula depend upon the different anatomical condition of the eye. There is a long study by Dr. Millis et al., which published in 2007, and it answered almost all the questions. And because this is a very accepted peer publication, because it has a huge database, it started with the more than 37,000 cases, but ultimately finished with the almost 27,000 cases. And it implanted only the studies on the axis of single phase and axis of IQ platform, that is SA6080 and SA6000. And he categorically divided into three groups, less than the 22.5 axial length and 22 to 25.5 and more than 25. He also divided keratometry subgroup, less than 42 and more than from 42 to 46 and more than 42. And he compared Barrett Universal 2, Olsen, SRK2, Holliday 1, Holliday 2, Hofer Q, and Higgy. Let us start what we got from the first answer we got from this study, which formula is most accurate in all range of eye axial length. You can see there's in this case, the Barrett also, the clear winner, almost more than 50% cases is within 0.25, 0 to 0.25. And if you consider the 0.5 to 0.75, it is almost 94%. And nearest is also Olsen. And other formula is much behind. And now the second question is, which formula is most accurate in all range of axial length? And here again, the Barrett, you can see the blue color is less than, is a hypermetropic eye. Normal is green color indication, and the hypermyopic is more than 2.22, 5.5 is the myopic. And here is the almost Barrett has the almost accurate result in all kind of lens, all type of axial length. And next is again also become the next. And whether we have actually believe previously that the Hofer Q is a good for the small eye, that is a smaller eye, but here you can see in this study Hofer Q has a significant error in the shorter eye. And next is the IOL power. From the, you can see the red line, it is Barrett has a consistent result up to the 28.5 diopter. In the chart, it is almost near the baseline in Olsen. Next is the again Olsen. Olsen gives a consistent result also. And this is a comparison of the axial length. If you consider the smaller eye, and all again, the Barrett is a more consistent, followed by the Holliday 1. Holliday 1 is a very good give you the result in when it comes to the very smaller eye. And also, and all the lens, all the other biometric formula almost same. But if you to come to the slightly larger eye, it is a 24 to 28 diopter. You can get the again, Barrett is a more consistent. And second is Olson, and you can see this is a holiday holiday one is give the most erroneous result in the longer run. So which formula, again, the question number third and fourth, which formula most accurate in the eye of all range of keratometry value? And the question number four is the all kind of anti-chamber. Again, if you see this Barrett is the more consistent, and after that, it is the Higgins give the most consistent result according to the anti-chamber. Then, contrary to the belief, where the Olson calculation depend on the C factor is depend on the ACD, but this is seen that the variation in the Olson value. Probably Mill is explained, this is the earlier formula of the Olson he used. Now the Olson has come out with the newer formula, which is available in the factory optics platform. Probably we explain this phenomena because the Olson has the most variability with the anti-chamber depth. And keratometry average, again, Barrett and Holiday gives the good results. So what is the effect on Van Gogh modification axial adjustment? You can see this is a, I just skip this slide. You can just see the SRKT. SRKT has definitely there is an advantage. Otherwise, in the longer eye, SRKT going to the hypermetropic postoperative diffraction, its adjustment, there is a definite is a myopic reversal. So the Van Gogh adjustment is really needed for in higher axial length for these formulas. Again, you can see the Higgins, there is a hypermetropic shift in postoperative diffraction almost all the cases, but its adjustment is myopic patient is a bit the wrong. But in Higgins, that this adjustment actually not very helpful. So it's a Barrett in the is the more acceptable and give the more accurate result in all kind of length, all kind of axial length, all kind of keratometry value, all kind of anti-chamber depth. So why the Barrett is so popular? If you use so it came to the prediction that when you are use only one formula, it is better to use the Barrett universal too. And again, it's a very good synchronizes the one of the best study calculator, that is a Barrett calculator, and Barrett 2K, which is already discussed, partly discussed. It is very good formula in post laser cataract in post resolution correction. But now it became the total keratometry value, which improves the Barrett result further. This is the TK universal 2, and there is also is coming the TK toric calculator and Barrett TK. This TK is basically game changer of the IOL calculation. This Barrett TK formula is really give a excellent postoperative outcome in all kind of premium IOL. The purpose of TK is to replace standard keratometry, aiming to help reduce the outline and improve the refraction outcome of the IOL calculation. And probably in the coming future, this TK Universal 2 will replace Barrett Universal 2. So what should be the postoperative refraction in case of premium IOL? And in my case, in phase bypass correcting IOL, when I use the TK, then my bifocal IOL minimum myopic diffraction in case of Barrett universal 2, but when I use the TK, I use minimum myopic spherical equivalent. It gives very good result. And even in the trifocal, if I use the TK formula, Barrett TK universal 2, I use the myopic minimum myopic spherical equivalent. And if I use the Barrett universal 2, it is minimum myopic refraction. And for EDOF, I keep my patient slightly myopic, at least 0.75 myopia in the spherical equivalent in the first eye, that is in dominant eye, first eye or dominant eye or non-dominant eye, I keep at least 1.25 spherical myopic spherical in the EDOF IOL. And toric IOL, I always try to, for ATR, I always try to give the minimum residual cylinder at sleep axis and WTR, because I want to correct ATR more, and WTR or minimum residual cylinder at 10 axis. So biometry journey, we have come from ultrasound to structured biometry. So it's in our clinic, it's workflow should be, biometry should be done always in bilateral, and it should be done pre-dilatation biometry, and it should have the investigator name. So training of the investigator who is doing the biometry is very important. He has to validate the biometry report, whether it is coming right or wrong. I am giving some biometry value. You can see this is at least a trifocal. It's the normal lens of axial lens. And if you see the Barrett, Hill RVA, and also almost give the same result. This is almost the same result in all cases, whereas the SRKT has been slightly different from the Barrett or Olson or RGA. And TK is, this is a TK, how you see the IELMaster 700. This is a anterior curvature, and this is a posterior curvature reading. Here is a 0.9, because it's a WTR, and definitely when the posterior axis is deducted, it is a less what it's showing. So if I go for the this is the validation, how to validate your biometry in IELMaster 700. It's a nice tool. Your investigator must know how it give the accurate result. It's a fixation check. You can see that telecentric reading in the biometry, but here it is not actually perfect, and let's see what biometry result ultimately be. You can see this keratometry value is uncertain. If your investigator goes through the whole report, that machine give you automatically, and it validate your report, that reading automatically. This machine is actually give everything that you can check at least 5 points whether you are taking right biometry or not. If again you see that axial length, there is an exclamatory mark, and that means there is a fixation loss. Again, in IELMaster 700, it is automatically calculate the Barrett TK Torrey. And as I said, when I use face biopic correction lesson, that is a trifocal, I skip to the lowest spherical biopic spherical equivalent. And when I use the biometry, you can see I use this green, that is a universal two. That is, I always prefer to give some amount of myopia and residual. So ultrasound barometry, if in a premium IL, today's scenario has no role because we are not able to use the all kind of latest formula here. And definitely, so it is has no role. You have to use either optical biometry or structured biometry. The optical biometry has a disadvantage, often is also very good, but often fails to in PSC nodal point. Very small PSC in nodal metal, optical biometry fail to give do a biometry. And ability to penetrate advanced cataract is not possible in case of because of optical biometry. And surprisingly, in IELMaster 700, and can give almost accurate biometry result, even almost very advanced cataract, almost in a mature cataract. So, and unusual eye like lens steel can detect in IELMaster 700. These are the advantage of the IELMaster 700. It is accurate axial measurement, lens measurement, three zone keratometry, posterior keratometry, total keratometry, ACD, aqueous depth, lens thickness. It gives the CCT, white to white, angle cuff, angle alpha, and reference image for marker less surgery to attach with the Calypso marking system. In conclusion, Barrett Universal 2 or Barrett TK Universal is the most popular and oil accepted formula for the premium oil, even in all kinds of oil. And Hill RBF, RBF with the AI-based database formula will improve constantly over time because it increases almost, Hill RBF 3 has almost more than 30,000 data, and it will improve over time definitely, and it gives a more accurate result. And soil search biometry is the improvement choice. It's better to invest a little more in the soil search rather than for the future. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Arup Bhomik. I think that was a complete primer on IOL power calculation, very nicely explained, right from the theoretical aspects to all the practical aspects. I think it is time to play the sponsors video. So, Sunil, can you please play it on? And we'll come back again after this. Thank you, Sunil, for that. And any questions, Chitra, you would want to ask?
Yeah, before going to the questions, yes, I just wanted to summarize very briefly that the advantage of these advanced formulae is that we are very able to accurately estimate the effective lens position. If the IOL in the bag is a little anterior, you're going to get a myopic outcome. If the IOL is a little posteriorly, it's going to get a hyperopic outcome. So all these latest formulas have so many variables incorporated. It's not just axial length and K. It's ACD, lens factor, white to white. So all of these are adding up to get that kind of accuracy in measuring the ELP. Again, in very small eyes, the small eye could have a normal anterior chamber depth, could have a small anterior chamber depth, could have a large anterior chamber depth. In large eyes, we could have a staphyloma. So the measurements may be difficult. So in all these things, because these factors are incorporated in the formulae, you are able to use them in extremes of axial length and post-LASIK eyes and all those challenging areas. So your refractive surprises become less. But again, I would want to add for the audience, like, there are many people who in their early days cannot get an optical biometer. So what you need to understand is immersion biometer is pretty good. Of course, IOL Master 700 can penetrate dense cataracts and get great results. It has a fixation check and everything. But with the immersion biometer, what you have to do is you can still use Barrett's formulae. Only thing, when you're entering the K value, all the values from the axial length values from the immersion into the Barrett's formulae, which you can get access to online, you should remember that you have the acoustic IOL constant is there. So you need to enter that, which comes in all the boxes of IOL power, because with an immersion ultrasound, you are actually measuring the anatomical axial length, whereas with the optical myometers, you are measuring the optical axis. So that gets more accurate. And there is a small factor which has to be adjusted. So if that is entered, then you could avail of the Barrett's formulae online and get bang on good results too.
Thank you. Thank you, Chitra. I think that was a great tip. I wanted to ask Dr. K.K. Mehta, sir. Sir, you said that 70% of your practice is now premium IOLs or multifocal intraocular lenses. What percentage would be your torics amongst premium IOLs, or what percentage would be your torics?
I would think more than almost 40% of all the lenses which we do are toric. And that is what surprises me when the companies come out with lenses without toric, because unless you get a perfect toric result, you're not going to have a problem. And the other thing which has been my pet peeve for many, many years, and I've complained all over the world actually, not only in India, is that the company should start giving us lenses with quarter cylinders, because that is essentially what is required.
Yeah. Okay. So, and would you think that if you compare the manual marking versus the mark,
it is significantly, it is significantly better, because very often when you're marking at the patient, I mean, I'm pretty good at it, because in all the olden days, we only had that to mark on. So, but if you, after the time we have stopped utilizing marking it on the slit lamp, either utilizing a pinpoint area or utilizing a marker, which you fitted on the slit lamp, utilizing this system, it really makes a difference. I mean, if I would frankly suggest, if you have enough turnover of multifocal lenses, then you should consider going in for some automated system, whether it is Zeiss or Alcon, irrespective. Zeiss is, of course, a better system, but you need to have that. In the end, it makes a lot of difference. If your volume is there, certainly proceed with it.
Yes. Again, in younger practice, I'm sure if they mark it well on the slit lamp or with the bubble marker, they could do pretty well too.
Yes, but you must remember to mark it in the sitting position.
Yes.
And be sure to get your perfect horizontal line, because patients tend to move their head. That's a big problem.
So I think there's a comment from Dr. Sugato Paul, and he says that one thing we should avoid is to feed ultrasonic biometry data in online Barrett formula without changing the A constant. So I think you did say that, and this is again important thing which should not be missed.
Absolutely. So,
and one other thing also is the Barrett TK, which is there with IOL Master. I mean, that works for the Barrett formula and the Haggis suit only. Probably for Holiday 2, I'm not very clear, but it does not work for the other formulas. So you should remember this, especially AMO toric calculator and the other toric calculators. They have devised their own way of accommodating for the posterior corneal astigmatism. So if you feed in the Barrett TK, which has measured the posterior cornea, and they already have a posterior corneal astigmatism calculator, so it would be as if you are doing the correction twice. So, and I'm not very sure it would allow at all in the first place. But having said that, TK now is applicable to specific formulas only.
Dr. Rajesh, you would want to ask from any...
I would just like to... ask sir, KK sir, that, you know, for the benefit of audience, sometimes when we align the IOL, there is some parallax error, and because of the head tilt, etc. So your tips on, you know, how to prevent and minimize that parallax.
KK sir.
Well, you see, if you're marking it through a slit lamp and utilizing the eyepieces of the slit lamp, your parallax error is comparatively less in marking. The problems only come if you're utilizing an operating microscope. But as long as you are center your microscope properly, it is perfectly fine. The parallax tends to occur if there's a tilt in the head of the patient, especially a horizontal tilt running downwards, then the problem tends to occur. But otherwise, I don't think that is really too much of a problem. And the one advantage is if you use this marking system, it is... You literally are marking it, moving it exactly to the same plane which your instrument shows you. So we know that it is remained stable.
So thank you so much, sir, for your talk.
I have one query for Dr. Arup. I mean, he has loads of experience, and that's why I would like to know. You mentioned that for EDOF lenses, you keep a target refraction of minus 0.75. In the dominant eye and minus 1.25 in non-dominant eye. In my experience, what I felt that I keep between minus 0.5 to minus 0.75 in both the eyes, and bilaterally they have a very good, absolutely, you know, fine near vision and intermediate as well as distance. So what is your experience?
So,
Minus 1.25 is not a myopic refraction. It is a spherical equivalent. It may be 0.5 spherical and 0.5 minus 0.5 cylinder. Or it is maybe the 0.5 spherical with minus 0.75 cylinder. So that is my maximum target. The generally, I always keep tight to be within the myopic side. But otherwise, it is fail to give vision nearer to the 60 centimeter. So at least you have to satisfy your patient at least 40-45 centimeter. So that it is it of lens not able to give vision near vision in 33 to 40 centimeter. At least it should give at the range of 60 centimeter, and you can somehow convince the patient that you can manage. And over the time, patient after first postoperative days or the second postoperative, they complain about the near vision. But over the time, the beauty of the EDOF lessons, they never complain about the near vision over the time. In the next visit, when they come in the myopic, there is a residual myopia, after 6 months, they'll not complain about their near vision because they already habituated their reading distance to at 60-65 centimeters.
Is a beauty. Thank you, Dr. Arup. I think we'll move to the next talk now by Dr. Anand Shroff, and he is going to be talking to us about his experience with a swept source IOL Master 700. Unmute yourself, Dr. Anand. Dr. Anand, you have to unmute.
Yeah, I am unmute. Thanks.
Have to share your screen, no?
Yeah, share. Ma'am, Dr. Chitra, I'm happy to be here and meet all of you. So I'm going to start now. Sorry, excuse me.
Actually, primarily you have to thank Namrata. Even I have to thank her for being in this.
Oh, no, come on, everybody. It's a whole team effort. Yes.
So I actually was told that there'll be many topics about formulae and other things. So I instead decided that I would talk about my observations in my practice with the IOL Master 700 and what difference it has made in the practice. So I'll tell you a little bit about my journey. When I started working in the late 90s, about 97, 98, we had the Allegan Humphrey A scan, and we had to be so careful observing from the side to see that we don't have any sort of pressure on the cornea, making sure I just touch only the tear film. And then suddenly in 2001, two things changed a lot for me. But in the beginning, there were very few phaco surgeons doing foldables, with very little refractive surgery happening. So there was always this, there was never this thing about that I shouldn't have a number later. There was no concept of refractive cataract surgery. It was more about the whole marketing was more about going to office immediately. They were told, okay, you can go home, take off your patch and go. Some doctor wouldn't put a patch. Just say, okay, you can just wear the dark glasses and go straight to office. There was a lot of that happening. And so therefore, the whole concept was a bit different. But there always was a need for multifocals. There was always a small bunch of people who said, I don't want to wear specs. And that started to grow over time. And therefore, there was a definite need for an accurate biometer. So in 2001, I think it was the end of 2001, we made the switch, and it was a huge change because all of a sudden it didn't matter who was doing the A scan. I didn't have to recheck anything. And suddenly all that operator dependence just went, all the variable results went away. Of course, they didn't go away because if you had a tougher, harder lens, then you still had to be a bit careful. But the refractive surprises in a standard cataract were gone. And then, of course, because of that, we found that we had to shift over to immersion far, far faster than we actually would have liked to. I mean, because with immersion, it was a big sea change from going from a simple A scan. So the early IOL masters that we used in the early 2000s, between 2001 and around 2010, is that we had to learn tips and tricks of how to get around a posterior subcapsular cataract, go a little on the side and try and shoot and things like that. Mature ones were of course really hard to do. Signal to noise ratio was an important aspect of the whole thing. So we had to quickly shift to immersion because of that. There were still refractive surprises we saw. In 2009, we shifted to the accommodative IOLs, which we used for about 3 or 4 years. And then somehow they just went out of vogue. But in 2009, when we were using those, we shifted to Holiday 2, which, we had to actually make sure really accurate, because this was the only lens that came in 0.25 jumps. And so therefore you couldn't even really blame the lens. You know? So it just had to be so accurate. We did a topography for every case. And it was a great learning experience. I'm not saying that lens was great, but it really taught me a lot about A-scans. So the IOL Masters 700 compared to what we had with the 500 is a huge, it's a sea change. It's like all those tougher, all the tough ones we had, we used to always get stuck, but it's actually like moving from a car to an SUV when you're on a rough road. It just takes every single cataract so easily into its stride, whether it's a hard cataract, it's black, it's white, it's a PSC, dense, anything. It just does a fantastic job. So of course, for us, what is also important is that the keratometry is now improved. So we don't have to do a topo also in every case, because for us, in our setup, what we do is if there's anyone, the 0.6, 0.7K, we immediately try to switch over to a toric lens. So in my EDOFs and in my trifocals, we are nearly at 75 to 80% toric because of an accurate reading. So anyone over 0.7, 0.75 gets, if your incision is not going to be in the same axis, then we switch over to a toric lens. So with my EDOFs, where I use the mini well, I'm probably about 85% toric. So that's where we've had a great sea change, even in fixation check, which I think is a fantastic thing that they have on the IOL Master 700. So if you don't get a fixation, it's very clear with my staff. If you don't have a fixation check on, as in you're not on the fovea, you recheck it again. And for us, that is the key to everything, because that is the difference. Fixation is one, and the second is that the Ks have to be really matching. And so therefore, for us, that's the real difference between choosing a toric and choosing a spherical IOL. With the IOL Master 700, it has really saved us time because of not having to do a topo in every case. All the formulae that we've had and seen and everything is fine, but we still tend to switch to the Barrett formula because I've tried everything else and I just find that this is really accurate. Of course, you've had a whole talk on this, so I won't go into the details of it, but it's been really helpful. In our practice, as I said, the fixation check is our number one thing. We always make sure that we have a perfect fixation. The IOL Master 700 has made it very repeatable and quick. The keratometry has helped tremendously in choosing IOLs. The cataracts now, our immersion rate is less than 1% now. So there's practically none at all. It's very repeatable. Even if we have a new optom, it's very fast and it just makes the whole workflow really quick. So in the main reasons for incorporating an IOL Master 700 was, number one, it's a real workhorse. We've had them right from the beginning, and they're built like tanks. Anyone who uses it, even if it's mishandled, anything, it just keeps working. All our like IOL masters have been chucked aside only because of Zeiss not being able to hand us parts or saying that now it's obsolete and you have to get it out. But we've never had a non-working machine. It's just something outstanding. Right from the first IOL master of 2001, they have never given us a day's trouble. So I, in fact, had a lot of options of choosing these A-scans. And though the IOL master might be a little bit more expensive, it's worth every penny because it never gives you a bad day. The other thing is that it's extremely reliable in all the measurements. Of course, because of the fixation check, it's really, really easy to look up. I mean, to be sure that you're on the right track. The issue here is that we have got crazy expectations nowadays. Even after telling a patient that this lens will fit into a bag which is hanging in the middle of your eye, we're not sure whether we will. And plus, we have jumps of 0.5s. So we will try our best to make sure that you don't have any PARs at the end of it. Yet the expectations are extremely high. In fact, as we move to extended depth of focus lenses, as I said, we are doing a large study on the mini-well, actually, because in my opinion, that's the one lens that gives you very close to trifocal results. The only problem there being that with an extended depth of focus of that kind that is as expensive as a trifocal, the only issue there is, number one, if you go hyperopic, you're gone. Because he's got, even though they may see far vision really well, the near side just drops to N14, N18. So they're very unhappy. Second point about extended depth of focuses like that, which offer good near vision, is that strangely, if you go to minus 0.5 on the sphere, suddenly they say, I can't see far at all. And you have your near vision, what happens is that the near vision is spectacular. They're all N6, but then they can't see far and they get really upset. If you have a SIL which is 0.75 or more, then again, there's a thing, oh, doctor is not very clear. So with lenses like the mini-well, you have to be extremely accurate. But once you have that level of accuracy where you're within 0 to 0.25 on the sphere, 0 to minus 0.25 on the sphere, and you're within half a SIL on the toric, what happens is that they're extremely happy after that because they have it literally becomes like a natural eye. So I'll try to give that study within the next month or two. That's a fairly large study and we've gained a lot from that. And the more important thing is that we've got really accurate with our A-scans only because that lens is very, very difficult to make sure that everything has to be absolutely perfect, which I find that with the trifocal that I've used from probably 2016 or so, I found that that's a bit more forgiving. But even then, when I'm all these years that I've used the Zeiss trifocals, again, I just did a recent study on that. I found that about 85 to 90% of them were toric. And one thing must be said about Zeiss and its trifocal lenses that this plate haptic works like magic. I mean, once it's in and it's the right place, it's bang on every single time. And there is no rotation of the lens at all. I think it's probably because the rings are on the posterior surface, but it really makes all the effort of doing a good A-scan really worth its while. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I just want to make it brief. I don't want to go on and on. So
I cut a few
slides just to get to my point.
Yeah, thank you. No, it was very educative in the sense about your own experience with the IOL that you're using and also your own experience on the IOL Master. And I think we've had a great session. Rajesh, would you want to ask any questions?
No, actually, very well emphasized, very good presentations. All the presentations were very crisp and very, very nice, to the point, actually. And I felt the emphasis on the combination of this swept source OCT and the you know, this three-zone telecentric keratometry measurements, the advantage of, you know, the fixation problem getting solved with this. So, and of course, the penetration of the IL-Master 700. So all these things gives it a distinct advantage and a distinct edge over other devices currently present in the.
So we would like to thank all the speakers here who've taken out time with us today for sharing their experience and also for their contributions, and would like to thank all the delegates and all the audience who are watching us on Facebook, YouTube, and on our Zoom portal. And a topic like this, decoding optical biometry and formulas, is tough to understand, but always, you know, attracts a lot of members, a lot of AIOS members, and a lot of ophthalmologists, because it always remains an enigma. And the more you, you know, watch it or more you see it, the better you get. We would like to thank our sponsors, especially Mr. Shivakumar and the entire Zayas team for sponsoring this webinar, and our support system of the audiovisual team, Mr. Sunil and Mr. Kripal Rana, from the AIOS headquarters for putting it all together. So thank you very much, and we hope to see you again on another webinar. So till then, goodbye and stay safe, and looking forward to meeting you again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, Namrita. Thank you,
everyone.
Bye.
Thank you, Namrita and Rajesh. Thank you.
Chal, Sita, see you later.
See you later. See you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. It was really nice. Arup.